Good morning. Welcome to our fourth annual No Place Like Home Conference. Good to have you here. Appreciate you wanting to gather more information, some education about today's topic is long-term care. We're going to cover hopefully the whole thing in different chunks, but we're going to talk about what is it, what does it cost, some ways that we can plan for it, how to pay for it, and then do you have all this taken care of in your estate plan already? So those are the topics for today. Want you to, jot down some notes, although we will be forwarding you some information. And we will be cutting each of these sessions into a podcast that you can access again after you're done. And if you know somebody that should be listening to this, so parents, you got kids that need to hear this, kids, if you need parents, need to listen to this, that will be available to you. We are streaming from Revel Eagle, which they've just been so kind. Silk Higer is the administrator, and she's got us all set up. We're in a gorgeous little apartment here. That's our studio today. And so thank you to her. Thank you to Revel Eagle. And then thank you to all of our participants. I think you're going to find today very helpful and very informational. So joining us first is Katherine Owens. I've known Katherine for, you'll find out, it's a long time, and she likes to give me a bad time, and that's just kind of the relationship that we have. She is a senior living expert, and she is very, very adept at having those conversations, beginning those conversations about long-term care, that families tend to avoid. But if we can at least get started, that would be a great result of what we're doing today. So, Katherine Owens, who is back east with her grandson, and she's joining us via Zoom. So this will be Zoom within Zoom. Katherine. Way of introduction, you are a senior living expert. That's what you've done for years, couple of decades anyway.
Almost as long as I've known you.
Well, I think that's how we ran into each other. You have won awards for books that you have written. I remember your first one, Be Your Own Hero. Now, I know the rest of that is Senior Living Decision Simplified, but I loved the Be Your Own Hero because folks have to take control of this. And like so much of what we do as attorneys, if they don't take control of it, someone else does. So I loved that. More recently, Shine On You Crazy Diamond. And then I was just reading one on my Kindle. It's about difficult, give me the title, it's about difficult decisions and how to make them. And you have a large portion in that book.
Yes, it's Difficult Aging in Place Conversations, which launched last week.
Yeah.
And perfect timing for this incredible day that you're putting on, but really what you and I have done for 20 years is really help families facilitate those not so easy or fun, complicated conversations. So, yes.
Well, I was thinking about this yesterday, and I was wondering in the course of our conversation if we couldn't touch on the reasons that these decisions seem so difficult for people. And let me back up. I've got a couple that came to me recently, clients, been clients for a long time, very in rather robust health, They like to travel. They have a place over in Hawaii. Otherwise, they're at their timeshares around the world. And they came up to me and said, "You know, we listen to you," which is always scary. And they said,
I'm gonna not say a word. I'm just gonna hold my tongue.
"Thank you. Thank you." They said, "We started looking at some places that we might move and reduce our yard work and, some of the things about owning a house." Now, I haven't heard back what they've decided, but they were kind of, for me, a little bit out of the ordinary. So I want to get to that. I just set that up. Maybe we can get there today. First, people really have a lot of emotions when they hear that term age in place, or in my experience, they grab it. Oh, yes, I'm going to age in place. So define that. If we looked at the industry, that's a poor term, but if we looked at the industry, what does that mean, aging in place?
Well, that was really a good setup, Mark. And it sounds like you've not only read my chapter, but this is something you and I talk about quite a bit. And really, the premise of my original book, Be Your Own Hero, Senior Living Decisions Simplified, and that is that these are hard conversations. And when people hear the word aging in place or senior living, there tends to be more of a black and white of, and as you said, people gravitate. I'm staying in home. And we have associated the term aging in place with staying in our home through end of life, or staying in our home through end of life defines dignity and autonomy and independence and control. And really, as you and I have discussed, aging in place is, and it's a term I like to use, it's putting in place what you need at every stage. And you and I really focus on two different things. You really focus on helping your clients get the documents and the things in place and the finances and all of those things that are going to give them peace of mind and get things set up and protect them. And I do that when it comes to decisions as people are aging. But one of the things I mentioned in this recent book was that we associate aging with place with our latter years in life. And aging in place is something that we do our whole life. And so through our whole life,
Yes,
we are putting in place.
by the way, yes. You have that in the book, and I was reading that and I was going, yeah, we change. And we change where we
We
live,
do.
we change situations. I tell people kids grow up, they move away, and that again, we have changes that we have to address. So thank you. Sorry, I interrupted.
Oh, you're absolutely correct. And the reason I point that out is that we put in place and change our location, change the support that we have, change the, our idea of what we enjoy or the next phase of our life is a constant evolving thing. Yet we get to these later years in our life and we have now defined it as staying stuck in place in our home. And that gives us the end all quality of life. And, as we look at a holistic picture, we need those social engagements. We need peace of mind. We need to have opportunities to stay engaged and have sense of purpose and contribute our talents and stay physically active. And sometimes, like you said, kids age, and that doesn't mean we stay in the place that no longer suits those needs. So really, it's you and I have talked about, let's change our mindset from aging in place and what we have associated with that to really putting in place, regardless of what it is, putting in place what you need to age well at every age. So I love that you're doing this today.
Well, thank you, and thank you for being here, by the way. Good to have you again. So there's a couple of things I think you mentioned that people kind of cling to. I have to stay in my home because that gives me autonomy. We'll talk about that. Dignity. I'm not quite sure why we have dignity in the house that's maybe too big for us. And we wouldn't have it. This is a lovely apartment, by the way. You did a good job. And so this is a lovely place. And I don't know why there's not dignity here. That's a struggle for me. And quality of life. You and I have talked. My mom collected people. She knew everybody. So when she finally made that decision to be in an independent living situation, she adopted everybody. She knew everybody. At her funeral, the folks that had worked in that community, even those that had moved on, sent cards and flowers, and several of them attended the funeral. And that changed my thinking, to the good about what it is that we can do as far as quality of life. So that was too much. I took too much time. So help us, walk us through autonomy, dignity, quality of life, and why do we see it so? It's hard. And people see that I got that at home, but I can't have that anywhere else.
And I might upset a lot of people, but that's not new for me. And maybe that's why you and I get along so well. I am going to say, sometimes in this industry or the aging industry, we have contributed to that. And we build businesses around that. And we... And I'm going to just share an example. It's a commercial that I saw once for a home care agency, and they're all of the siblings are standing around mom, and they've got the care provider there, and they're in the mom's home. And they said, you know, we promised dad that we would do whatever we could to keep mom in her home through end of life. And I'm thinking, why didn't you promise dad that you're going to put the things in place that mom needs through end of life, to have the best quality of life? So I think it starts with us changing our dialogue of, you need this to stay in control, or you need this to have dignity. And one thing I ask my clients to do is define dignity, because for you, dignity may be completely different than what it is for someone else, or autonomy. I mean, I'll just give an easy example. If someone is in their home and they're no longer able to drive or shouldn't drive.
Yeah.
That's an easy one. Now they're stuck in their home. They're isolated. So what gave that person joy, maybe going out and having lunch with girlfriends or going to religious affiliations, whatever it was, all of a sudden, now they're dependent on someone when they have time to come take them. So, okay, what would give them independence? What would give them the opportunity, or what environment that would allow them to do what they love to do? So instead of just being a black and white, for your individual self, define, what is independence? What is autonomy? What is quality of life? What gives me joy? And then where can I best continue that opportunity?
Well, I love what you just said. There's what gives you joy. You know, what gets you out of bed in the morning? What do you look forward to? And where is the best place to find that? Now, I should back up. We're not saying everybody needs to move out of their house.
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
But the decision process has to be very intentional. And you said the same thing I've seen. People have cut off this entire range of options. They just cut it off. Well, I'm not going to even think about those. And I know with my father-in-law, after about 3 weeks in a independent living with his wife, he looked at us like, well, why didn't you guys think of this? After we had that conversation.
I'm not even going to tell you how many times, maybe close to 100% of the time,
yeah,
I hear that.
Yeah.
And You and I were discussing the other day. I was asked a question in regards to the book, Difficult Aging in Place Conversations. What are difficult conversations and what are easy conversations? And the reality is, the difficult conversations
And
are the ones that require change.
we can start with the easy conversations. There's some things there we can start with, and then maybe move into the harder conversation.
Yes, have a conversation. Just have a conversation because you and I have seen a typical path is to just avoid the conversation. And one of the things I posed in this last book was to ask yourself, why is this conversation difficult for me?
Yeah.
What am I going to lose if I talk about it, or what am I going to gain? But typically, if it's something that requires you to step out of a comfort zone, to consider a change, to whatever it is, that's when it becomes difficult. But as you do for a living, is you help people prepare, you help people plan,
Yeah,
you help people look forward.
can we do that back here? Because I think it just dawned on me. Sorry, you're much brighter than I am. One of the reasons I think that's a difficult conversation is because there's a lot of people that know the answer. They don't want to hear it. They know what the kids are going to say, so they don't want to have that conversation. Because
No, they don't.
they don't want to be told what to do.
Which is the irony is they don't want to lose control and they don't want to be told. Yet at the same time, by not having the conversation or planning, they are not taking control. They are leaving it up to chance. And oftentimes what you and I have seen is they lose all control because now when they're forced to make a decision, they're basing it on an emergency or a diagnosis or something that is not in their control. So really, instead of fighting this, I'm going to lose control, take control and plan when you can plan. And it's funny because we both have met so many people that plan, that have been successful, that think ahead. They plan for the rainy day. Why aren't we planning for this stage in our life?
I find that extremely difficult. And that was, I saw in your book, you mentioned, we talked about just a minute ago, that throughout our lives, as our situations change, we've made those decisions. We hit them head on. We have talked to our team, our support team. Husband and wife sat down and maybe made some difficult decisions. We've been in this home, we've been in this congregation at church for long, we know all these people. But, as you've seen, when those kids move across country, what's holding us here? And I know this isn't an easy conversation. I just know that. But you had it. You had to, well, actually, can I cheat a little bit? You're having it. This is an ongoing conversation, right?
Yes, it is. And you bring up a really good point that throughout our life we have those conversations or we make decisions based on different things. Also remember that we have to change our course or a path at times throughout our life because there's things that happen that are out of our control or different things that come up or we realize that, life would be maybe a little bit easier if we did this, or you get a job offer, whatever it is. And so, being fluid throughout our life, whether it's easy or what we want to do, is something that all of us do because that's life. So, again, you stated earlier, people grab on and this is the only option. We still need to have plan A, have plan B, be fluid with the idea that life is still happening, things are going to change. My needs, wants, desires, concerns are going to change. And so all we're saying to people today and what you and I have spent our careers really
tried
saying is we're promoting education. We're promoting that you take the time, understand so that as you need to make decisions or as you start having conversations, you really can make educated decisions. And you really do understand this is what mom would prefer or this. I mean, you and I have seen this a lot of times. Spouses have completely different ideas of what retirement is going to look like. And they don't even realize it until that time happens.
Yeah. Well, and so we get to this point, and now we have to make some decisions. Well, I guess we don't. Well, we do have to, because not making a decision is also a decision. So we get to this point.
It's not a good one.
And rarely is it a good one, right? Mm-hmm. Rarely. So let me go back. We talked about a couple of things that make it hard for people to have this conversation, to, you know, sit down and intentionally prepare for what happens, you know, at retirement, after retirement, 10 years later, you know, that conversation. We have people that have an interesting concept of autonomy and dignity and quality of life. And I think that's part of what you're trying to do is to get them to envision that. What does it look like? You know, what are the points? And then there's an impediment in this decision-making process or talking to the kids because we're worried they're going to tell us. And I'm just sitting here thinking, yeah, they're going to tell you something you probably already know and you don't want to hear
it. That's why they don't want to hear it.
What are some of the other things that you find are in the way for people to make, well, to have that conversation? What else gets in the way? What are some of the other things we should be thinking about, talking about, and bring into that conversation?
One thing that's interesting is looking at mindset. And I say this because it gets back to kind of like what does someone define as quality of life, but people come at conversations differently. So I'll just take a couple, for instance, and I'm sure you have seen this, but if you have one spouse that really comes at things from a very practical, logical approach, you're kind of laughing because you know where I'm going. But then you have another spouse who is really more emotionally driven, socially driven. They have this whole idea that's completely different. And so they're trying to have a conversation, yet neither one of them are considering where that person is coming from. But what happens is I see that with adult kids as well. The adult kid is wanting peace of mind. They're wanting to make sure that mom is secure. They're wanting whatever it is. And mom has a completely different idea or a different mindset on what is important to her. So sometimes that's even, I tell people to take a step back and just say, again, define what's important to you. We should really talk about this. Is this a hard conversation? Why is it a hard conversation? And I went through this with my mom recently. I know she doesn't like to talk about finances. And at the same time, I'm helping her manage those finances. And she finally admitted when I said, why is this difficult for you? She was worried that I was going to, she's a tithe payer. She's religious. That as I'm managing money, maybe I would say this is not important because we have X, Y, and Z. But for her, that is something that's incredibly important. It is her sense of purpose. It is things that make her feel like she's contributing. It has been a way of life. And just say, help me understand. Or why is this difficult?
It
really does show that you care about how someone feels. And you're not telling, you're asking. Help me understand.
That was, I was slow to learn that. You know, I'm in a business where I talk to people and the goal is to listen, right? To hear where they are and what, you know, their concerns. if they became incapacitated or at their passing. And so you would think that working with my own mom, I would have done a better job of hearing what she had to say. And it took me, well, it took us kids about 2.5 years mm-hmm. of conversations and learning how to express our concern. She had a couple of falls. She was in a house that had concrete stairs up the front and in the garage, and there was no handrails or anything. I think that we had to learn how to express our concern for her safety. This afternoon.
Without taking away her dignity if she can't manage it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so I see that as a challenge. Do you think that that just is perceived as being so hard that we just aren't going to go there?
Yes. And as you were talking, and I think I've shared this story with you before, but again, I think as kids and just as people in general, people probably feel that way because we come at it that way. And so maybe even as parents with our kids, we can see that they would be happier if, or that they're not managing it. I had a really interesting experience. I had was working with a woman who lost her husband, and she no longer wanted to stay in the house. She wanted to move to an independent living community, and she fell in love with this apartment and kept asking her daughter, well, what do you think about it? And her daughter just kept saying, Mom, it has to be your decision. I know, but what do you think about it? Mom, it has to be your decision. And no decision was ever made. What really was the issue is she had never made any significant decisions without her husband.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so again, it's not about, you know, why can't we have this decision? Why aren't you making a decision? Why aren't we talking about this? Taking a step back and saying, why is this decision hard for you? Or what can I do to support you in making a decision? Or what would be the easiest way for you to have a conversation about this? Because when it came down to it, she actually needed and wanted her daughter's help, and her daughter was trying to let her have her dignity and autonomy and control. And so they were at like opposites, and they didn't know it because they were both trying to support each other, but it had nothing to do with what the struggle was.
And easy to see from the outside, all the daughter had to say was, Mom, it's really cute.
I like
that mm-hmm. apartment. You know, that sort of a thing. And that would have helped Mom to make that decision. And I can mm-hmm. talk to you about a number of decisions that Mom made, you know, after she, you know, talked to her kids. And I think fortunately, we kids were pretty much on the same page. You know, not mm-hmm. not every decision, not every, but we were supporting Mom. And so when she asked, she got a handful of responses that were, no, I like this, Mom. I really like this place. And that's what she was looking for. So I hear you.
Needed the validation.
Yeah. Okay, so let me see if I can set this up. We have, what I've seen, the folks that are on today, we have those that are at this place in life where this is a conversation to have. And we have kids that have parents in this, you know, stage of life trying to make these decisions. Tell me how you start this conversation. I'm at home. I've been there. I'm kind of entrenched. It's maybe not the safest place. The kids are concerned. How do you start this conversation?
Sometimes people don't know what conversations they need to have or want to have. So one thing I like to give people questions, because again, this is them thinking about why things are hard for them. So what are conversations that you're avoiding? Or what are conversations, especially those that really are looking at maybe I need to start making some decisions? What are conversations that are difficult for you? And just start jotting those down. Why are those difficult? Why do you keep avoiding those? And what would you gain by not having that conversation? And what would you lose by having the conversation? So again, we might think that we know what the conversation is someone needs to have. So just start out with, what are conversations that are hard for me to have, or what conversations am I avoiding? Because especially if you're a couple, maybe one is about making a move. Maybe one is about downsizing. Maybe one is about bringing in home care. Whatever it is, take the time to really think about, and nothing's wrong, there's no wrong answer. What are these conversations that I'm avoiding, and why am I avoiding them? And what am I going to lose if I have them?
Well, and what options are there? This is education now, right? What options are there? And why am I struggling to understand what options I have? That's a struggle for me. As an attorney, we're always looking at options and we're weighing them and trying to figure out why that one won't work and why that one won't work. That's our job. That's what people pay us to do. But when we're in those situations, it's funny because not terribly funny, but interesting that people will cut off these options. No, I'm not going to do that. So
it's
what
because of these preconceived ideas or maybe stigmas that we've associated with it. And again, going back to, if someone was to sit down and define what gives me quality of life, and again, that could change, but at this time, what gives me quality of life? Being able to have social engagement, you know, whatever it is, what makes me feel independent, or all of those things, so that as you, and then educate yourself, start looking at options so that as maybe needs change, you know which ones would allow you to keep your independence or to keep the things in place that give you quality of life. Yeah. People look at what they're going to lose, or they perceive they're going to lose, instead of what they would gain. And so again, all these questions are in my Be Your Own Hero book, but it's because no one can give you the answer. But when you're looking at options, what would I gain if I was to put this in place? Maybe more independence. What would I lose if I was to put this in place? Think about when you're looking for a house and you have this whole wish list. You know, I want a 3-car garage. I want 3 bathrooms. I want to have an east-facing view, whatever it is. And how many realtors in your life have said, you know, okay, this is great. Understand that maybe you're not going to get everything on the list. And so you start looking at what's important on the list. So it's kind of fun to put down, what are things that I want? What are things that give me quality of life? But also kind of grade the importance on them, because I'll give you an example. Revel. So when I was opening Revel, Revel does not have a swimming pool.
What?
And I had, it does not have a swimming pool. Sorry. I had a gal that was moving from out of state that swam every day. It was incredibly important to her, and it gave her joy. It kept her active. It was a social thing. She did not want to lose that.
Yeah.
And so she had in her mind that I have to be at a community that has a swimming pool. So I asked her, I said, tell me about what swimming looks like for you now. And she lived in a gated community that had a swimming pool. And she said, you know, I get dressed, I get everything I need to go to the pool. I go to the pool, I swim, get changed, come home. I said, how would that be any different at Revel? If you got dressed, went a mile down the road, swam, got dressed, came home. And she said, well, it really wouldn't be any different. And the other question I asked for her is, when you're not swimming, what in the other 23 hours of the day is important to you. Because it's so easy to get fixated on this one thing or what we perceive we have to have. It has to be right there in the community, when in reality, she was driving to a swimming pool on the other side of her community every single day. So sometimes it's just about thinking, okay, what does that look like for me now? How would that be any different if I made a move?
That's interesting because I think we tend to live in those spaces where we've decided I've got to have this thing. I know it was difficult for my mom until she spent a week there. And then after a week, it was like, okay, why didn't you guys think of this? She loved going to breakfast and the gals were at breakfast, right? And they get to brag on their kids and their grandkids and, you know, and then when the kids and the grandkids visit, then they, you know, they compared. And she looked forward to that. And there's an interesting story with her. They had church services in the community. With COVID, they had to shut those down. And then they went to a streaming like this and did, you know, church services streaming. And it was very, very difficult for her. It was very difficult for us to visit. Interestingly, what gave her joy, she confided in me after about a year of this. She said, "Son, I love to sing. I love to sing the hymns. And I love to sing them with people. And I miss that." And so for the first time, well, I shouldn't say for the first time, but that was a really sharp example for me of getting clear. Now, she had her piano in the apartment and some of us kids play, and so we would play for her and sing. But that was interesting. It took that whole thing to get clear on this one thing that brought her great joy. Not just a little bit, but great joy. And that made a huge difference for her.
It does. And that's why conversations can be hard or considerations of something new, because at all ages, change is hard. And to your point, you can't always envision what something's going to look like. She had to go through an experience. Yeah. She had to feel it, taste it, touch it, be in the community for a week. She had to be without it. But again, that's why that exercise of what is important to me. And so I'll just use the being in the community. If you have someone that enjoys having breakfast every morning, and I would say to myself, if they weren't living here, who would they be having breakfast with today?
Yeah.
So, yes, and that's when that whole idea that our homes give us dignity, quality of life. What gives you quality of life? And for her, it's being able to have conversations every morning. It's being able to sing with other people. It's not four walls. And so she can have four walls anywhere, but where can she have the greatest opportunity for the things that give her joy?
So we've spent a lot of time talking about maybe moving out of the house. Let's talk, maybe we just have a few minutes left, but let's talk about decision making that maybe says, no, home's okay. My house is okay for me. What are the considerations?
Exactly. And I put in the chapter that I did in this difficult aging in place conversations, really it's about putting in place things that allow you to continue to enjoy the environment that you're in, or an environment that allows you to continue to enjoy the things that you like. So that may be moving, that may be staying in your home. Again, taking the time to understand options for what that would look like. So maybe when you start losing a little bit of mobility, maybe making some modifications and planning for
Yes.
that because that
Yes.
may cost. Or choosing a home. Nowadays, you can buy a home that, you know, has wider doorways, you know,
Yep.
and people again say, well, I don't ever want a grab bar, or I'm never going to use a walker.
Yeah.
Again, you know, if this is really important to you, and understand it might not work out, but if it's important to you, set yourself up so that you have the best chance of
Yep.
having that happen. And again, just because you have a conversation doesn't mean it's going to happen. I wrote Be Your Own Hero for a person making decisions and the person supporting them making decisions, which is typically you and I, the adult kids.
Yep.
And it's funny because even with a book, the people that need to make decisions avoid it. They avoid a book because it might make it real.
Yeah.
It's just a book. It's a conversation that says, hey, I need to start thinking about what's important to me, and I need to start having that conversation with the people that are going to be a role in helping me make that happen.
And I don't know that you can start that conversation too soon.
Never. Okay.
We
people
can
say, when should we have that? Before you need to have that.
Yes.
When
back,
you have
back here, yeah.
Yes. And I hate to use this example, but when should I get a life alert button? Before you have a fall. Because once you have a fall, it's not, you know, it's so. And you go through this all the time when people are planning for their wills or estate planning, all of
powers
those things.
Powers of attorney. When do I need that? Well, before you need that.
Yeah, it isn't something that now I've hit 80, I should do that. It's something that life happens at every age.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. All right. We've just got a few more minutes here. I came up with the thought long ago with the estate planning because that's so hard. It's a very similar thing in that people don't want to talk about dying, or at least that's what they say. I've had some absolutely beautiful conversations when people have finally opened up and we've had that conversation. So it seemed to me that type of planning, whether it's a, you know, what happens if I'm incapacitated and then what happens at death, seems to me that that is an act of pure love for your family.
I have used those exact words myself.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's
100%.
And it's an act of courage.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to step out in, you know, out of the light, out of this, you know, I'm just so good right here. And then you have to step out of it and have that conversation. And it seems to me it's the same thing here. It has to be that
yes.
you're expressing your love to your kids, and it's an act of courage. You said it's hard to make changes. It just mm-hmm. really is, and I get that. Well, listen, how's the little one?
He is energetic. But he is part of why I focus on aging well. He is my longevity plan. Trying to keep up with a 5-year-old boy, and you've got grandkids, so mm-hmm. you can appreciate. Yes.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't have it any other way.
5-year-old granddaughter, and she's hysterical. Oh, well, thank you so much for your time this morning, Katherine. Tell us your books and maybe how to get them.
Thank you. It has been a pleasure. It's always a pleasure to talk with you. And Be Your Own Hero, Senior Living Decisions Simplified, again, for adult kids and older adults making decisions. The whole premise of that book is to facilitate difficult conversations. So it's packed with questions for both. And then Shine On You Crazy Diamond was just really a personal book, but it's a book for women, and it's just about empowerment. And then Difficult Aging in Place Conversations. I would encourage anyone to look at that book because I was one of 28 industry experts or authorities that contributed, and there are conversations you would not even think about in there and how to facilitate those. So it's one of those books, there's something for everyone. You may not need it now, but it may, you may need it down the road. So
how do we
all
get
of
them?
Those are on Amazon.
I have them on Kindle, so I had my phone up this week and I was reading your newest one. So you can grab those. It seems to me that you could use those to initiate a conversation. All right.
Yes.
Well, we have to quit. We need to do this again sometime where we've got more time. So thank you. You know, we're going to take a break. I call it the bio break. Some people need, to take care of some things and maybe some caffeine. After that, we've got Robert Vandermeer, who you know, Executive Director of the Idaho Healthcare Association, and we're going to kind of get down and dirty on some costs and maybe try to get our head going in that direction. We will see you back here at 10 a.m.